Harper Children's Audio presents Seekers, The Quest Begins by Erin Hunter. Performed by Julia Fletcher. Copyright 2008 by Working Partners Limited. Series created by Working Partners Limited. Production copyright 2008 by HarperCollins Publishers. Chapter 1. Kallik. A long, long time ago, long before bears walked the earth, a frozen sea shattered into pieces, scattering tiny bits of ice across the darkness of the sky. Each of those pieces of ice contains the spirit of a bear, and if you are good and brave and strong, one day your spirit will join them. Kallik leaned against her mother's hind leg, listening to the story she had heard so many times before. Beside her, her brother, Takik, stretched, batting at the snowy walls of the den with his paws. He was always restless when the weather trapped them inside. "When you look carefully at the sky," Kallik's mother continued, "you can see a pattern of stars in the shape of the great bear, Sillaluk. She is running around and around the pathway star."
"Why is she running?"
Kallik chipped in. She knew the answer, but this was the part of the story where she always asked. "Because it is the snow sky, and she is hunting. With her quick and powerful claws, she hunts seal and beluga whale. She is the greatest of all hunters on the ice." Kallik loved hearing about Sillaluk's strength. "But then, the ice melts," Nisa said in a hushed voice, "and she can't hunt anymore. She gets hungrier and hungrier, but she has to keep running because three hunters pursue her. Robin, Chickadee, and Moose Bird. They chase her for many moons, all through the warm days, until the end of Burn Sky. Then, as the warmth begins to leave the earth, they finally catch up to her. They gather around her and strike the fatal blow with their spears. The heart's blood of the great bear falls to the ground, and everywhere it falls, the leaves on the trees turn red and yellow. Some of the blood falls on Robin's chest, and that is why the bird has a red breast."
"Does the great bear die?" breathed Takik.
"She does," Nisa replied. Kallik shivered. Every time she heard this story, it frightened her all over again. Her mother went on. "But then, the snow sky returns, bringing back the ice. Sillaluk is reborn, and the ice hunt begins all over again, season after season." Kallik snuggled into her mother's soft white fur. The walls of the den curved up and around them, making a sheltering cave of snow that Kallik could barely glimpse in the dark, although it was only a few paw lengths from her nose. Outside, a fierce wind howled across the ice, sending tendrils of freezing air through the entrance tunnel into their den. Kallik was glad they didn't have to be out there tonight. Inside the den, she and her brother were warm and safe. Kallik wondered if Sillaluk had ever had a mother and brother, or a den where she could hide from the storms. If the great bear had a family to keep her safe, maybe she wouldn't have to run from the hunters. Kallik knew her mother would protect her from anything scary until she was big enough and strong enough and smart enough to protect herself. Takik batted at Kallik's nose with his large furry paw.
"Kallik's scared," he teased.
She could make out his eyes gleaming in the darkness.
"Am not," Kallik protested.
"She thinks robins and chickadees are going to come after her," Takik said with an amused rumble.
"No, I don't,"
Kallik growled, digging her claws into the snow.
"That's not why I'm scared."
"Ha, you are scared, I knew it."
Nisa nudged Kallik gently with her muzzle.
"Why are you frightened, little one? You've heard the legend of the great bear many times before."
"I know," Kallik said. "It's just... it reminds me that soon snow sky will be over, and the snow and ice will all melt away. And then we won't be able to hunt anymore, and we'll be hungry all the time. Right? Isn't that what happens during Burn Sky?"
Kallik's mother sighed, her massive shoulders shifting under her snow-white pelt.
"Oh, my little star," she murmured. "I didn't mean to worry you."
She touched her black nose to Kallik's.
"You haven't lived through a Burn Sky yet, Kallik. It's not as terrible as it sounds. We'll find a way to survive, even if it means eating berries and grass for a little while."
What is berries and grass?
Kallik asked. Takik wrinkled his muzzle. Does it taste as good as seals?
No, Nisa said. But berries and grass will keep you alive, which is the important thing. I'll show them to you when we reach land.
She fell silent. For a few heartbeats, all Kallik could hear was the thin wail of the wind battering at the snowy walls. She pressed closer to her mother, feeling the warmth radiating from her skin.
Are you sad?
She whispered. Nisa touched Kallik with her muzzle again. Don't be afraid, she said, a note of determination in her voice. Remember the story of the Great Bear. No matter what happens, the ice will always return, and all the bears gather on the edge of the sea to meet it. Sililuk will always get back on her paws. She's a survivor. And so are we.
I can survive anything, Takik boasted, puffing up his fur. I'll fight a walrus. I'll swim across an ocean. I'll battle all the white bears we meet.
I'm sure you will, dear, but why don't you start by going to sleep? Nisa suggested. As Takik circled and scuffled in the snow beside her, making himself comfortable, Kallik rested her chin on her mother's back and closed her eyes. Her mother was right. She didn't need to be afraid. As long as she was with her family, she'd always be safe and warm, like she was right now in their den.
Kallik woke to an eerie silence. Faint light filtered through the walls, casting pale blue and pink shadows on her mother and brother as they slept. At first she thought her ears must be full of snow, but when she shook her head, Nisa grunted in her sleep, and Kallik realized that it was quiet because the storm had finally passed.
Hey, she said, poking her brother with her nose. Hey, Takik, wake up. The storm has stopped.
Takik lifted his head with a bleary expression. The fur on one side of his muzzle was flattened, making him look lopsided. Kallik barked with laughter.
Come on, you big lazy seal, she said. Let's go play outside.
All right,
Takik said, scrambling to his paws. Not without me watching you, their mother muttered with her eyes still closed. Kallik jumped. She'd thought Nisa was asleep.
We won't go far, Kallik promised. We'll stay right next to the den. Please, can we go outside?
Nisa huffed, and the fur on her back quivered like a breeze was passing over it.
Let's all go out, she said.
She pushed herself to her massive paws and turned around carefully in the small space, bundling her cubs to one side. Sniffing cautiously, she nosed her way down the entrance tunnel, brushing away snow that the storm had piled up. Kallik could see tension in her mother's hindquarters.
I don't know why she's so careful,
she whispered to her brother.
Aren't white bears the biggest, scariest animals on the ice? Nothing would dare attack us.
Except maybe a bigger white bear, seal brain,
Takik retorted. Maybe you haven't noticed how little you are. Kallik bristled.
I may not be as big as you, she growled, but I'm just as fierce.
Let's find out,
Takik challenged as their mother finally padded out of the tunnel. He sprinted after her, sliding down the slope of the tunnel and scrambling out into the snow. Kallik leaped to her paws and chased him. A clump of snow fell on her muzzle on her way out of the tunnel, and she shook her head vigorously to get it off. The fresh, cold air tingled in her nostrils, full of the scent of fish and ice and faraway clouds. Kallik felt the last of her sleepiness melt away. The ice was where she belonged, not underground, buried alive. She batted a chunk of snow at Takik, who dodged away with a yelp. He chased her in a circle until she dove into the fresh snow, digging up clumps with her long claws and breathing in the sparkling whiteness. Nisa sat watching them, chuffing occasionally and sniffing the air with a wary expression.
I'm coming for you, Takik growled at Kallik, crouching low to the ground. I'm a ferocious walrus, swimming through the water to get to you.
He pushed himself through the snow with his paws. Kallik braced herself to jump away, but before she could move, he leaped forward and bowled her over. They rolled through the snow, squalling excitedly, until Kallik managed to wriggle free.
Ha!
She cried.
Roar! Takik bellowed. The walrus is really angry now!
He dug his paws into the snow, kicking a spray of white ice into their mother's face.
Hey!
Nisa growled. She cuffed Takik lightly with her massive paw, knocking him to the ground.
That's enough snowballing around. It's time to find something to eat.
"Hooray, hooray!" Kallik yipped, jumping around her mother's legs. They hadn't eaten since before the storm, 2 sunrises ago, and her tummy was rumbling louder than Takik's walrus roar. The sun was hidden by trails of gray clouds that grew thicker as they walked across the ice, turning into rolls of fog that shrouded the world around them. The only sound Kallik could hear was the snow crunching under their paws. Once, she thought she heard a bird calling from up in the sky, but when she looked up, she couldn't see anything but drifting fog.
"Why is it so cloudy?" Takik complained, stopping to rub his eyes with his paws.
"The fog is good for us," Nisa said, touching her nose to the ice. "It hides us as we hunt, so our prey won't see us coming."
"I like to see where I'm going," Takik insisted. "I don't like walking in clouds. Everything's all blurry and wet."
"I don't mind the fog," Kallik said, breathing in the heavy, misty air.
"You can ride on my back," Nisa said to her son, nudging him with her muzzle. Takik rumbled happily and scrambled up, clutching at tufts of her snow-white fur to give himself a boost. He stretched out on her back, high above Kallik, and they started walking again. Kallik liked finding the sharp, cool scent of the ice under the dense, watery smell of the fog. She liked the hint of oceans and fish and salt and faraway sand that drifted through the scents, reminding her of what was below the ice and what it connected to. She glanced up at her mother, who had her nose lifted and was sniffing the air too. Kallik knew that her mother wasn't just drawing in the crisp, icy smells. Nisa was studying them, searching for a clue that would lead them to food.
"You should both do this too," Nisa said. "Try to find any smell that stands out from the ice and snow."
Takik just snuggled farther into her fur, but Kallik tried to imitate her mother, swinging her head back and forth as she sniffed. She had to learn everything she could from Nisa, so she could take care of herself. At least she still had a long time before that day came. All of Burn Sky and the next Snow Sky as well.
"Some bears can follow scents for sky lengths," Nisa said. "All the way to the edge of the sky, and then the next edge, and the next."
Kallik wished her nose were that powerful. Maybe it would be one day.
Nisa lifted her head and started trotting faster. Takik dug his claws in to stay on her back. Soon, Kallik saw what her mother was heading for. A hole in the ice. She knew what that meant. Seals!
Nisa put her nose close to the ice and sniffed all around the edge of the hole. Kallik followed closely, sniffing everywhere her mother sniffed. She was sure she could smell a faint trace of seal. This must be one of the breathing holes where a seal would surface to take a breath before hiding down in the freezing water again.
"Seals are so dumb," Takik observed from his perch on Nisa's back. "If they can't breathe in the water, why do they live in it? Why don't they live on land like white bears?"
"Perhaps because then it'd be much easier for bears like us to catch them and eat them," Kallik guessed.
"Shh, concentrate," Nisa said. "Can you smell the seal?"
"I think so," Kallik said.
It was a furry, blubbery smell, thicker than the smell of fish. It made her mouth water.
"All right," Nisa said, crouching by the hole. "Takik, come down and lie next to your sister."
Takik obeyed, sliding off her back and padding over to Kallik.
"Be very quiet," Nisa instructed them. "Don't move, and don't make a sound."
Kallik and Takik did as she said. They had done this several times before, so they knew what to do. The first time, Takik had gotten bored and started yawning and fidgeting. Nisa had cuffed him and scolded him, explaining that his noise would scare away the only food they'd seen in days. By now, the cubs were both nearly as good at staying quiet as their mother was. Kallik watched the breathing hole, her ears pricked and her nose keenly aware of every change in the air. A small wind blew drifts of snow across the ice, and the fog continued to roll around all three bears, making Kallik's fur feel wet and heavy. After a while, she began to get restless. She didn't know how her mother could stand to do nothing for such a long time, watching and watching in case the seal broke through the water. The chill of the ice below her was beginning to seep through Kallik's thick fur. She had to force herself not to shiver and send vibrations through the ice that might warn the seal they were there. She stared past the tip of her nose at the ice around the breathing hole.
The dark water below the surface lapped at the jagged edge. It was strange to think that that same dark water was only a muzzle length below her, on the other side of the thick ice. The ice seemed so strong and solid, as if it went down forever. Strange shadows and shapes seemed to dance inside the ice, forming bubbles and whirls. It was odd. Ice was white from far away, but nearly clear up close.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.